Okay, welcome back from lunch. Thank you to the arrangers for EVIC. I was here last year with a company that got completely torpedoed, Teva Pharmaceuticals. The stock is down some 50% plus due to facts that was actually not new. There was the opioid crisis case merging or coming from 2014, and then there's a cartel price case as well from 2016. But these two, which were well known, has developed into a perception and also legal reality. There's a huge settlement to happen at some point, and that has completely tanked the stock. They will report tomorrow, so I think we will notice that the underlying performance of Teva is doing okay, but this cloud of uncertainty hangs over the stock and will be doing so at least until beginning of 2020, when the settlement should be getting cleared. Okay, this year I continue in a pharmaceutical stock. We don't have just pharmaceuticals, but the fund that I advise, we have 34% exposure to pharmaceuticals. The second biggest is semiconductors, which is 19% exposure. And then it's renewable or new forms of energy, which form up the most of the rest in terms of exposures. This year, I'll tell you about a really big needle in the haystack. It's a stock I've been walking around the tree for ages, but only this year I said, okay, now there's an opportunity. And I'll just drop this one. You can read it when you get your slides. This one you can read too. By the way, value investing, this office of Advice Capital is probably 40 square meters. It's very cheap. Or inexpensive location, but it's central in Copenhagen, as you can see. So the case is Bristol-Myers. It's probably a case that most of you are familiar with, at least the name. It's one of the biggest pharmaceutical companies in the world. They've got revenues of $24 billion, estimated for this year. The blue ones in the donut chart are cancer drugs, and that's a big chunk of their business. And they're doing a transformative change to the company, which will make it the number one cancer drug company in the world going forward. But this is the way it looks today. And you can see 56% of the revenue streams is coming out of the US, and then it's 25% Europe and 19% rest of the world. So this is plain vanilla. They have no debt as it is today. There's a small net cash position and a market cap of some $80 billion. A bit of the history. Bristol and Myers are the founders of the company 130 years ago, and they developed into all this what is today. What I focus on is the Cancer Act in the US made in 1971, which was a very ambitious plan to eliminate cancer death a few years out. So far, it's been almost 50 years, and we're not there yet, but we're getting there. The Bristol-Myers journey, apart from doing into the cancer area, they've been very successful in cardiovascular drugs and also in HIV drugs over the years. And in the fast forward to the 2010s, they used to have a CEO called Andreotti, who is related to the Italian Prime Minister, one page eight. Does it still work? Andreotti left in 2015. And then another Italian name, Caforio, got the baton to drive the business into the future. The first couple of years, he spent kind of getting to know the business in detail from that position. And in early 19, they came out with an announcement they're buying another US drug company called Celgene, which is coming out of the biotech industry and have a very good cancer drug called Revlimid, which is the lower box on the slide. And Bristol-Myers cancer drugs is called Opdivo, is on the upper side. Putting those two together, they will have the biggest revenue stream in the cancer space in a few years' time, or when the whole thing is merged. So why cancer drugs? Because cancer drugs is by far that category in the pharmaceutical space that is growing the fastest. There might be some smaller ones, but if you take the big categories, cancer drugs is growing from 124 billion last year to 240 billion approximately in 2024, and comprising almost 20% of the total drug market. Merck, oh, you can't see in this one, but Merck, they've got a drug called Keytruda, which is the leader of the pack today. It's estimated that Keytruda by 2024 alone will have a revenue stream of 24 billion and then making the best-selling drug ever in the world. And for those who do not know Keytruda that well, the former president, Jimmy Carter, was treated. He was diagnosed I don't know when it was, like 2 years ago. And then he was told, you're finished, but you'll go into more experimental treatment with Keytruda, and today he's actually pretty well. I saw him on a YouTube where he was out, he's doing houses in his time off. He's 92 years old, and he was sitting there hammering, and apparently it hammered the hammer into his face. So there's a big scar, but that's got nothing to do with his cancer disease. He's up and going, and cancer, a Keytruda drug, due to that story, has got much more traction the last 2 years, which you can look at the Merck stock price and also Keytruda sales, which has, to some extent, made Opdivo sales flatten a bit out. Also, Opdivo indications turn out to be less positive than what the initial hopes were for, and they are now, they've reformulated some of the tests. They have fast-track approval on 20 more indications. So by 2021-22, the Opdivo drug is supposedly going to see a faster growth track going forward and then catching up with Keytruda, even though it is not going to be as good as Keytruda, but combined with the drugs from Celgene they're buying, those combinations will put Bristol-Myers into number one position. All right, the transaction is basically buying, then announced the $25 billion transaction in January this year. That's when Bristol-Myers got back on my radar screen because the stock tanked due to this. What they're buying is basically a $17 billion revenue stream with a 55% EBIT margin for $75 billion, as mentioned. Then in the spring, even though the deal is not closed, they raised, Bristol-Myers raised $22 billion in bonds. In June or July this year, they sold the only stone in the shoe to get the regulatory approval in the US, which is the psoriasis drugs. They got estimates with, that they would be selling it for $10 billion. They managed to sell it to Amgen for $13 billion. And right now we're just waiting for the deal to close. And I think the minute the deal closes, Bristol-Myers will update with new guidance. And the new guidance is, my guess, on the right-hand side of the slide. Yes, right-hand side. Is that the new company will have a revenue stream of roughly $42 billion. They will have $20 billion of EBITDA. CapEx is tiny, just $2 billion a year, at least company size. It's a small amount. And at the close, they will have net debt of around $30 billion. There's also, as a Celgene shareholder, you'll get cash, you'll get Bristol-Myers shares, and then you get one unit in the Celgene pipeline called CVR. It's probably going to be renamed into something else. But if you put all this together, suddenly you have a company making $6 a share, from previously $4 a share. So the profile, this is the revenue and EBIT margin, because you have a high margin company getting together with one with a lower margin, but we get into a position where you have a 40 plus billion revenue stream with 40 plus EBIT margin. So they're going to generate a lot of cash. The cash position, that's a red line. Obviously, they go into deep red once the deal is consummated, but only after a few years they should be able to repay all the debt and get back to where Bristol-Myers has been for ages. in a net cash position, or around zero. In my EPS numbers, I have not included any stock buybacks, even though that's the history of the company that do stock buybacks. So if you throw in stock buybacks, the 2022, 23, 24 EPS is not $6.50, $7.50. It could obviously be much higher, depending on how they how they use the cash they generate in that period. But nevertheless, it looks inexpensive in terms of valuation. It's a deal that will put it into a pretty strong position going forward, and the debt is not at the same level as Teva last year, which has a lot of debt. This one is maneuverable, and when I look back in my book for my scorecard for what kind of cases I've made the most out of, it's Samsung, bought in the late 90s during the Asian crisis. It's Royal Unibrew, bought just after the financial crisis 2009. And then there was the SIP, today it's called Telecom Italia, after they made something called the Piano Europa, digitalization of the Italian networks from 88 to 1992, which almost indebted the company, but they got out of it as people, they got into digital telephony in Italy. So indebted companies have actually generated very good alpha the way I've experienced. So I'm not afraid of this one, even though it has that. So the risks are, and the bigger the circle, the bigger the risk. Financial risk is obvious. I think I've mentioned it already. Then there's the market risk, because with 56% in exposure to the US, and you got the Democrats election next year, Democrats Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders out with some pretty straightforward suggestions that have probably got a very populist appeal to how to reset and make healthcare affordable for more Americans than it is today. That could be a risk that you take the drug makers and say, listen guys, you have to reduce prices. Obviously that will detract the attractiveness of Bristol-Myers. The regulatory risk, I think, is pretty low, but you have always, there's a new system, well, it's not that huge, 5 years old, BTD system in the US where we have new drugs from small companies where the FDA actually hold their hands and help them through the process. So the filing of millions of pages is made much easier, and how to get the drug approved is made easier with the help of FDA. This also goes for the large companies, fortunately, and as mentioned before, Bristol-Myers themselves, they have 20 drugs in the BDD for the time being. And there's only every year around 80 drugs going through on, well, there's currently 80 drugs on that formulation in the FDA. On the operational risk, I'd put it into green because I don't really see, they know how to run a drug company. You have the indications for Opdivo that is already known. I think from now on it's not going to get worse, it might get even better. Execution of the synergies with this Celgene acquisition, CELG it's spelled. And then for some, they see it as a problem that in 2026-28, there's a patent expiry in the combined group which is not currently addressed with something that can replace those revenue streams. Time will show what they figure out of new drugs in 2022, 23, 24 that can fill that hole. But currently that's part of the perception that is holding the stock a little bit down. And finally, the valuation risk, I could almost put into blue, because with the EV/EBIT of 10 times and PE of 9.4 for next year, PE for 2022 is 8.3, doesn't say here, so you can note that down. But it's on valuation terms, it's not very expensive. So looking vis-a-vis peers, and this is how I came across initially, because I've been following Genmab, a Danish cancer drug company that works together with Johnson & Johnson. For the EBIT CAGR 2016 to 21, they've got the highest growth profile, and measured on EV/EBIT, they are the lowest of the whole group. So just the growth profile vis-a-vis the valuation makes this a perfect stock in my eyes, because I use GAAP, growth at a reasonable price, and this one ticks out as a pretty good one. I know some of you have heard this case before, only recently, but I wanted to repeat it. I'll just skip the charts, because I think even though you can see the stock price has moved up recently, the blue one is pretty strong, there's good numbers, the likeliness of the deal going through in just a few months have increased quite a lot. So the stock has become stronger, and also there's been an appetite for pharmaceutical stocks within the last few months that has given Bristol-Myers a bit of tailwind. But in the longer perspective, since 2015, nothing has happened in this company, and now it's going to happen the next couple of years. This is the long chart. I don't even see it myself. I think it's from 1990. There was a big move when they had these cardiovascular drugs in the 90s and HIV, and then a big impact on the patent cliff, and now they're gradually coming back on the cancer drugs. But the way I look at it in various ways, it's either a $72 stock 2 years now from 2 years out from now, or it's an $81 stock, somewhere in that range, $70 to $80, which is pretty decent in a world where you get SIP in the bank account. The overall market, I'm not very optimistic about the overall market due to a mix of earnings growth and valuations. None of them are really supportive to get more than 5% a year, most likely. So when you can get something which is much higher, and this is a really big company, liquid, it's just a huge needle in the haystack. So that one is the second largest position in the fund for the time being. Questions? I think we saved a few minutes.
Hi, Ole. Great presentation. So there was an article recently in the Wall Street Journal about drugs being priced on the quality of life, adjusted quality of life basis.
Yeah.
And kind of that's becoming some of the prevailing thought in terms of the drug pricing, where to look in not just, okay, it works or it doesn't work, but how it works and what it means for the quality of life of the patients and putting a price on that. Is this something that could be a risk or an opportunity for companies like Bristol-Myers Squibb in terms of how they're pricing drugs right now, whether they consider it to be too expensive for what they should be doing, not expensive enough, things like that?
Okay, thanks. I haven't read that article, but I know of the issue. And when you're given your approval to get a new drug approved, you have to, the pharmaeconomical space of the 3 to 6 million patients you're putting in is what is the economic cost and what's the society benefit, especially in Europe, that's a big part of the approval process. So since the drugs get approved, it's because they've got a net positive to the total healthcare spend. And you could say, now the US is probably the worst of them all, because healthcare spending is, as I recall, it's $1.5 trillion. But the drugs is only 10% of that. So it's the warm hands, the insurance systems, it's, you know, the whole system around it, where the drug companies, if they can say, we can reduce number of bed days in hospital by using this drug, that's the way they get them approved. So I think the big guys, they have an advantage, but the BTD system also gives the small drug companies, or a lot of them are biotechs, they give them the advantage to get into the market, which would otherwise be very complicated because they have to do all these calculations.
Any other questions?
Otherwise, I have a comment.
Okay, go ahead.
Where's Alex Rober? I don't know if you're still here. On this tech thing or valuation thing, the smallest position I have is a very small one. It's a relatively new market in the stock in the market. It's called Slack. We use it internally. It's a chat function which is outstandingly good compared to the Bloomberg chat rooms or any other chat rooms you have. And they currently have 15 million members. Each, the average spend per member is $40 a year. Just some simple work on how they are going through the market is that I think they could have 50 million members in 2024, and they've got a gross margin close to 95%. The operating metrics is selling, a little bit of R&D, So the EBIT margin is on the other side of 50. So on 2024 numbers, I can calculate this company, which is today is outrageously expensive. I can see it's got a P of 6. So value investing is also going into these kind of ideas that could actually work out very well just a few years out. But because most asset managers only look 1 or 2 years out, or even just quarter to quarter, things like this kind of get screened out very early. But it's outrageous expensive, so it's the smallest position you can have. It's just to force myself to follow it, and I use the product, and hopefully it works. Anyway, thank you.
Thank you, Ole.
Thank you so much.